Yo, welcome back, guys, to Seats to Recup 5. It's time for a very special match. In my opinion, the most fun match of the day. It's E-Cup versus Reynad. Because both of them are in everything, apparently.
That's the game versus Alligigo.
Yeah, E-Cup's been here. He's actually the only other person besides me and Nimsh who's been to every single Seats to Recup. So he brings some history with him. He was here in the first one where he lost 0-8 and officially got coined 08 Cup.
Ooh.
And he specifically was on the couch trash-talking Artosis to the oblivion, talking about how bad of a player he was. And then Artosis 4-0'd him with Murloc Zoo.
Sweet, sweet justice in Hearthstone.
That was really good times. And then I'll fast forward to here. E-Cup hasn't exactly had the greatest results. He's a player that I think is still underrated, even though he hasn't done well. What do you think, Gaara?
I would agree with everything you're saying.
Thank you. That's a good co-cast.
Yeah.
Wow, you're smart, Froden.
Thank you. Thank you, Zalay.
You go 6-0 with Meme Shaman today?
I might have. I may have.
All right.
I might go 12-0 next group stages, too. Who knows?
That Wild Growth card is pretty good. I'd probably keep that one.
It's a fantastic card. But here's something interesting. Reynad's playing Rogue. Do you have an opinion on this? I think out of all the players here, you're the best at Rogue, Zalay.
I mean
on our couch.
Okay, yeah. I feel like Rogue's fine. It's something I've been practicing a lot, so it's not something I wanted to bring, but it's certainly not too bad of a choice. It's kind of like either you play the best decks or you play a lineup that tries to beat the best decks, and that's kind of what Reynad's going with, trying to beat the best decks rather than play them. So he's going with Rogue and not banning Warrior.
Do you like the strategy, Eloise?
Rogue could be his weakest link if he didn't manage well. Like, for example, this Reynad's lineup might be crushed by Dragon Warrior and Face Shaman.
Yeah. Did he ban Shaman?
He banned Shaman.
When you bring Rogue, you ban Shaman, yeah. And then all of a sudden Rogue's pretty good. But it comes at a cost of banning Warrior, which there are a lot of different good Warrior decks, and it's hard to repair for all of them.
Yeah. I kind of made the comment that there's more viable Warrior decks than viable classes currently in Hearthstone, which is, like, really weird. But yeah. That's kind of cool. I mean, that means the class itself is really... well-designed in the sense that it's got so much cool variety going for it.
Well, well-designed or...
overpowered.
Highly powered, yeah. Fiery Wind Axe, not a bad card.
But I mean, it's so insane. Okay, Gaara, you were saying this, that even like one expansion ago, we were cutting Fiery War Axe because of how insane Deathbite was, and we didn't need that card.
I mean, we weren't cutting it regularly. It was like one very specific deck that happened to be very broken and very weird, right?
Yeah, but it's like
everyone it's not like a card you regularly cut. It's
I know. But that's just kind of like the relative power level.
Okay.
Kind of stuff. So
there's a lot of going on in this game already, by the way.
I think
this prep draw was pretty sick from Reynad.
Like he has your prep sap type plays.
What do you think about this matchup, like the Yogg Druid compared to like a Ram Druid or Khatun Druid?
I think that
Khatun Druid and Ram Druid is like almost unwinnable. Like against...
How do you beat Sab?
Yeah, how do you beat Sab? But how is Yogg Druid? Isn't it just doing better because you can flood the board
well,
and there's no flurry?
The 10 drops are a pretty big deal. Like, if you can just survive the 10, sometimes you can Innervate or Wild Growth, get there a little bit earlier.
By the way, can you ever come back from this situation? Like, Rogue goes prep, like Valley Teacher prep Sab against Claw?
Yeah, if we get like an Innervate Yogg kind of drop.
Oh, I see.
That's usually the out. Although I saw a game earlier that Hotform played with Tempo Mage where he won so quickly that Innervate Yogg was not an out.
Oh, that's pretty good too. He actually had the available option too, though, right?
No, the cards were not there, and if the cards were there, you were still dead.
So he won by 5.
Yeah.
Savage Roar?
No, it was Tempo Mage, and you just smashed.
Oh, Tempo Mage. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Actually, Swipe Roots is pretty sick, to be honest. That's like the only thing that would be good.
To kill the teacher?
Yeah, like what else could he have done for 5 mana? Just replay the claw, which is like awful most of the time.
Yeah, you want to kill that teacher.
Oh, yeah.
I like Swipe Roots. It's 2 spells played for Yogg, so that's like 20 damage to the rogue's face.
Yeah. But now he's like always behind because he's not developing stuff, he's removing stuff.
He's not always blind, he's behind until turn 10 and then he wins.
Yeah, I see.
Yeah, it's like...
Turn A with Innervate. Be Wild Growth, so it's actually turn 7.
I mean, you joke.
It's getting easier and easier.
You joke, but it's actually kind of true. It feels like he's going to forever be in that position
do
unless Rogue whiffs.
Most lists don't run Deadly Poison anymore. People play one poison.
Even
one
with
poison.
Deadly Poison, I might be hitting here because we're just so close out of cards in the Rogue's hand that we're likely to be re-daggering soon. And therefore, you just get that one damage in.
And he already used the one sap, so he cannot sap the Solas and the Ancient of War.
Okay, so you could trade twice to not lose anything to Solanas. That's an option.
Bad, right?
It feels bad.
So we feed him SI? Like go face and play deadly SI? Something like that?
I want to mention, like, 3 seconds ago, we were wondering if the Druid ever wins this game.
Yeah.
And now it feels like maybe Druid's ahead.
How does Rogue ever win if they don't draw cards?
But that's such a sick turn, right? Violet Teacher, Prep, Zap.
Yeah. It's
on curve.
Yeah, and it's not even that Rogue didn't have follow-up either. Rogue had follow-up.
Yeah.
It had Pillager. So it's like, that's one of the best follows we can do.
The hand is still pretty decent. Like, Talnos, Spell Power, Backstep, and Deadly. It's like, but the war is... I mean, as soon as he draws a second Zap, it's like win, right? For sure.
So we're going face for 8, Thalnos backstab like for face. 3, SI7, the...
That's good then again.
Okay.
Do you like
So we're
this?
Going for the passive line of play. We're... I mean, the issue here is, as Rogue, we have 4 cards and a coin versus Druid has 5 cards and is drawing a card sooner. So we're behind on cards and we're behind on mana. We have a little bit of a tempo lead, but like... The card count, we have Backstab and Deadly Poison as 2 of our cards. Those are pretty low quality compared to Druid.
Easiest
big ones.
Easiest gadgets in top deck of his.
Yeah?
Yeah.
I mean, he's got 3 cheap spells. It's pretty good. You're right.
Although we can't use all of it because he can't coin and Deadly Poison because he only has 7 mana next turn. But if he draws gadgets in his hand, it improves a lot.
You know what's a good play on turn 7? Just make a 5-10. Like when your opponent clearly doesn't have sap because they couldn't deal with your Sylvanas effectively.
Yeah.
Right.
Mm-hmm. That tends to be pretty good.
Headbiograph is a good card.
I don't think Spell Power is that threatening right now. He one of his cards is a coin, so he has 2 cards.
Yeah.
And if he also uses his cards as spells for removal, then it's like, well, he's out of cards.
Is he thinking about Druid of the Claw, Wrath?
This will give Rogue another card from Blood Mage.
So yeah, if you do the Claw and clear the Thalnos, then you have sort of a clunkier hand.
Oh, you...
Yeah.
He's going to kill the 3-3, right? There's no way he's going to cycle.
Okay.
I mean, he's so far ahead in the resource count, so maybe he just feels like the 4-6 is just, like, going to push his opponent out of resources. Everything's kind of like 2-for-1-ing his opponent right now.
So we have 6 health against 1 power versus 10 health against 4 power.
Pretty good draw. Help him cycle. Like, any kind of card draw cycles to use his mana is very good. Especially if he picks up Van Cleave.
So backstab fan trade seems to be where we're at right now.
Watch this Van Cleave. I'm just feeling it, man. It's like Rogue is such a momentum-based class sometimes. It's just like you just get these crazy draws that just barely keep you alive.
Yeah, that's pretty sick if he gets the... Whoa, do you like... No.
Saving the backstab. He's believing in the Gadgets and Auctioneer.
Oh, you...
Wow. Oh.
There it is, dude.
This
just
the
easiest Gadgets hand in his life.
That's some Heart of the Cards level skill right there.
Yeah.
You just gotta
Most
believe.
People did not believe.
Wow,
but
that's kind of sick.
That
I mean, we
really
are kind of like doing the Egyptian gods, and
Ooh.
I mean, this is a card game, so if you... to take that idea and
he took
figure it out. I mean, Reyna's basically like Yuki.
Okay.
No, he took a peek.
Actually, Reyna's like Kaiba.
Explain the thought, please.
Huh?
Finish the thought.
Because he's more of like the villain type of personality.
Reyna's the villain?
Yeah, totally, man.
Yeah, okay.
Instead of screwing the rules because he has money, it's because he has a big forehead.
Okay.
Can you imagine Kaiba yelling... Like, oh, I summoned my blue eyes white dragon. By the way, go to templestorm.com. if you use the promo code temp, you get 10%.
Probably. Oh, man. All right, so the coin's going to cycle here. Oh, he's playing the Argent Squire list.
So this is the argument against Argent Squire. It's really good on turn 1. It's really bad when you draw it off of Gadgets and Auctioneer.
Or just kind of like the late stages of the game.
Right.
It's a good combo enabler from even in the early mid stages of the game if you want to do like SI. But
wait, do you? Backstab the Squire.
Backstab the Squire? Oh, you have another Gadget Sand, so maybe he feels okay with just saving it for now.
Redirecting Squire. Feels good, man. It's okay. What's his win condition, Leroy?
It has to be.
I think this is JJ's list, because JJ was like the only one playing the Squire in the tournament.
JJ Sifko ran this and Shiv, I think, instead of Farseer and Shiv.
Yeah. He also has Yogg as an alternate win condition. His opponent's Yogg.
Oh, you're right.
I mean, he's believing so far.
I mean, Yogg kind of fights for himself. He's like the vigilante of Hearthstone.
Yeah, I mean,
he doesn't care. You know, like
if he overloads,
Mafia,
it's not your problem.
Yeah. You know, like Mafia. You ever play with a vigilante in Mafia?
That's pretty sick.
It's like and Eloise doesn't really understand. There's this game called Mafia where like it's kind of like everyone votes to kill one person in a group every day until you kill off the bad guys. Except there's this one guy who kills anyone he wants all the time, and he always ends up killing the good people.
We should stream Mafia.
We should.
That would be fun.
I mean,
that's
if the Hearthstone players,
super political.
That's super entertaining.
Yo, at People of Production, we should stream a game of Mafia. Maybe not tonight because everyone's tired from traveling, but maybe in like tomorrow or the day after.
Yeah. Like once people are eliminated.
Yeah. That's like a really good game with guys like Trump and Shrek going to Mavs. They
and
get
Forsen.
So into it.
Get a few
They're
drinks
such role players. Huh?
Mira gets excited about that game. I remember that.
All right. He has.
When Mitch is around.
He just built a great wall of China here.
Ching Chong.
What was that? Oh my god. Sick.
That sounds pretty good.
That's pretty sick, man.
Two Ancients of War, by the way.
The fuck? Reynolds is believing in the heart of the cards, man, even though it's Kaiba. I mean, we're changing the lore here.
I mean, he's right to believe, because if you don't believe, you're just simply not winning this game, right?
I mean,
oh,
you need good things to happen to come back from
this. This is so sick as well for next turn.
Kaiba does win some games in the Yu-Gi-Oh! Lore.
Yeah?
He's not, yeah, he actually beats Joey Wheeler very often, which E-Cop kind of is.
Okay.
Because, you know, Joe,
yeah.
Yeah.
I like it. E-Cop is like Joey.
Yeah, he's like Joey, man. He's kind of like the guy with the ridiculous accent.
A little bit dense game.
Yeah, he's like kind of silly, but he never really wins.
So he's saving the backstab so that the Van Cleef gets comboed
for 2 more
next turn.
But he's still in everything.
But he's still in every episode. Oh, poor E-Cup. I like E-Cup a lot.
Who doesn't?
I'm going to wear one of those E-Cup my homie shirts.
Yeah.
Or my homeboy.
I love E-Cup shirts. So he has the Yawk, so he has Lethal. But
well,
I don't know for
does
who.
He want it?
It's just 2 Pyroblasts away from winning.
Yeah, which way?
2 Ancients of War, by the way, in the deck.
Strong against Zoo?
Yeah, very strong against Zoo. That's a pretty good call, I think. Or even in the mirror.
Strong against Aggro Shaman. You're not seeing a lot of Hexes out of Shaman these days. Tends to be Aggro Shaman with Lightning Storms, right?
Yeah, you're pretty good against most Shamans, too. In general, I mean, just huge-ass taunts are just so hard to problematic get past these days.
Nice big butt.
Yeah. And Ancient of War just got the biggest booty.
Whew.
I mean, can you name one that has a bigger one?
Deathwing. See some play.
Yeah, that's true. I didn't think about Deathwing.
But it doesn't have taunt. It's not quite the same. You don't have to hit that.
Followed closely by Yo Mama.
Oh. All right, let's go, Kaiba.
This conversation too complicated.
Yeah, sorry.
So you need second fan here.
Basically, he's late. Mom has a big butt.
That's what we were trying to say.
It's gonna draw prep. Fan.
Oh!
He needs to draw prep.
Yeah, this is a good prep.
That's
how many preps does he use?
1.
Okay.
Let's go prep. That's good. And now prep.
Yeah. Dude, he preps, this game's over.
Oh, he still probably uses the Yawk.
No. Never Van Cleef.
Even if he hit the prep there, he loses the Yawk.
That was misplay. Never prep.
Oh, he gets prep now.
Imagine he draws. Oh, that's pretty good as well. But not for this turn.
Dude, that's just crazy.
That's so sick.
It's a lot of damage.
Rogue is a good
Miracle Rogue. Dude.
Maybe we can win past Yawk.
Oh, yeah, Yawk is still there.
Yeah, Pyroblast, 1 to the face. That's all you need. All
right, now let's
see.
Okay,
how unrealistic is it that Yawk kills? That's pretty reasonable.
It's pretty reasonable. Yeah,
you
2 minutes.
You can clear the board and play like Avenging Wrath, and that's just it.
It's the best bot state for Yawk. You want the opponent to have exactly 2 minions, and you to have no minions, and a bunch of spells being played.
Why exactly two? Why not like 3 for power shot?
Because something can... Oh, power
shot. Explosive shot.
Sick.
Yeah, that's true. But I mean, those don't trigger. Dark Bargain doesn't trigger on 1 minion.
Oh, yeah. That's a big issue.
Cleave doesn't trigger on
right,
one.
Right. It just plays and does nothing. Yeah. It feels bad.
But Akob haven't played much spell yet.
It just needs 1.
It can arguably be important to play Yawg early in the turn, so
you just
have
play
time
Yawg,
to react
strike
to the situation.
And pass.
I agree on that. If there's anything, like, you got to make up your mind fast on Yawg. He's not like a hot, cold, will he call me back, let's get back together next week type of thing. You need to go in hard.
He's a grim patriot.
Oh, let's go.
Yeah.
Let's go.
Oh.
Here we go.
We take it.
Ready for easiest doom.
Flame strike.
He just needs to clear the board.
Oh, we take this one as well.
It's irrelevant.
Great.
Oh. That one's relevant.
My God.
Wow.
What?
Who's the Miracle Rogue now?
It doesn't matter. No. The Rogue is like... Oh, Rogue wins.
Wow.
Oh. Easy. Oh, the Rogue wins.
Yeah, how'd you know, dude?
Did you see how much believing Reyna did this game?
That
was insane.
That was incredible.
He's Yugi, dude. And Yugi just beat Joey Wheeler again.
Take this, Yugi. By the way, we should tempo some.
Wow. Leaving the heart in the cars, Yugi.
All right, well, that's just going to wrap up the game.
And Cold Blood Lethal was a little better there because it was a top deck.
It was.
Yeah, that's kind of sick.
I like it.
All right, the easy game.
So, I mean, I wasn't expecting the game to be exactly like that, but Rogue can do that, for sure.
I mean, that was more about Yogg than anything, right? Yogg failed for once. It did not clear the board as it is supposed
to. But listen what Yogg did. Yogg set up a full board, concealed it, and then removed the minion. So it gained some tempo back.
Yeah.
But the,
and you died, but
Yogg didn't do its job. It's supposed to clear.
But
there's only like five or six spell Yogg. It's a very small Yogg.
Yeah, it was around six spells, and I think the chance to clear the board is around 45% or something.
At
I think,
10 spells?
Yeah, no, at 9 spells it's around 70%.
70?
Yeah, to clear the opponent's board.
To clear.
I mean, it depends a lot on what
you mean to play like an AoE spell?
Yeah.
Okay, because clear a board is not. I mean, that's like a Twisting Nether or
just,
like a
just
Banish
clear,
type
just
of
clear
thing.
Something.
70%, huh?
I like
those
odds.
Yeah, but he played only like 6 spells or something, so the chance was not that high.
So we have Dragon Warrior versus Miracle Rogue. A fairly 50-50 matchup.
Yeah, surprisingly more even than originally thought. I thought people, like, Dragon Warrior used to be pretty aggressive too with like Inner Rage.
We playtested this pro
deck. I think Dragon Warrior is kind of a little bit famous.
No, you won one.
This is a good moment. Rain Ed keeps the gadgets in, draws the second gadgets in off the one card he mulligans, and immediately just shakes his head like, never lucky.
Yeah.
That last game never happened.
Recency bias is really strong in this one.
Yeah.
I should say it in the Star Wars voice.
It's so hard to like predict what Reynard is thinking. He's like, yep, that just happened.
It was never lucky, baby.
I cannot do it in the Reynard voice. Who's the best Reynard impressionist? I mean, there has to be someone, right? Reynard is the best Reynard impressionist.
He's sitting here.
Yeah.
Can you talk like Reynard? Nobody can talk like Reynard.
So, Reynard, what do you think of Blood Mage? Oh, keeping Blood Mage or starting them?
SI7 agent's a gigantic beating here if he top decks
it. I mean, it's Arston card. That's the best I got. I mean, you just gotta croak with the voice a lot.
So he didn't draw the square turn one. He's pretty salty about that. You can see that on the facial expression.
Thank Play God SI7. For face cam so we can see Reynard's salt of 2016.
I'm pretty high
definition.
I think
with an HTML5 player.
I think he's still salty about the auctioneer.
Yeah. Like it's he's going to be salty about that all game. It's just sitting there in his hand reminding him.
He's thinking
you mulliganed one
Jesus.
Card. I mulliganed one card, and the only card I didn't want to draw was the
you're
second
right.
auctioneer.
Yeah. He just looks up to the ceiling. Just like, I think that's the worst draw on my deck.
That's one out of 29.
Literally the worst draw on my deck.
Yeah, he wouldn't say I think. Yeah. It's like, that is
literally
the worst draw on my
deck.
The
worst draw on my deck.
Yeah.
You getting frothy?
Yeah.
It's always a good time to get frothy.
Yeah.
Frothy's a good card.
It can just gets buffed too. It's pretty nice. You can't leave up the Thanos. Too threatening.
Yeah, I like trading.
Even though you missed the damage, ultimately you're still about board control. A lot of people compare Dragon Warrior to Secret Paladin in terms of it's like general game plan.
I think it's a lot more smorky than Secret Paladin. You have a lot of charge damage. You have some weapons, some things to say charge. Ragnaros.
In terms of its general game plan, though, maybe the macro strategy is just like you load up and then like somewhere around turn 6-7, you just start kind of putting way too much pressure for them to come back from.
Okay, I could see that. It's kind of I think a lot of aggro decks in Hearthstone are similar in that regard, in that the early turns are almost always about board control, and then you get a lead, and then
like Doomguard.
You find the right moment to start pushing for face.
Sure.
But for example, like Zul deck or Face Shaman, you always have a lot of choices, but for Secret Paladin and Dragon Warrior, there's only a few choices.
One card per turn. Play the big one, probably.
Have you guys tried, and I know you guys read the post, Wild's actually pretty fun, really glad no meta snapshot, etc. Have you actually tried Wild?
I've tried Wild.
And what do you think?
Have you ran into Secret Paladin? Fun playing against Secret Paladin.
Yeah, okay, thank you.
Like, it's beatable, but...
It's definitely beatable.
I have better things to do with my time, you know what I mean?
Priest is crazy.
Yeah, it's cool.
It's actually, I think, the best deck in the form.
Yeah, it's cool.
I would assume.
You don't like Nazoth Priest? what don't you like about Priest? He's not listening, don't worry. Gar. Oh, Gar's a priest player.
I used to be a priest player. But everyone forgot because I haven't played in so long.
Yeah, that's true. You used to love playing.
Wait, what class is that?
It's the priest class.
Oh, I don't know.
Gar, you're the priest. You were the chosen one.
Priest.
Priest is
priest.
I was talking with priest in Wild though. Seriously, guys, if you haven't tried it,
it's this ravaging ghoul feels really bad. Killing my own 3-1 and damaging my 2-2 just to kill a 1-1.
Reynard is an insane spot, right? Usually, the way how you kill the fairy dragon if you don't have coin SI is just take 9 phase damage.
Yeah, or basically like spell power fan knives another way, but that's about it.
But you don't have that because that would be like freaking Talos prep.
Do you like that ravaging ghoul?
I don't know what to say, but as Reynard here, we have our choice of clears. We could do something like Shiv Eviscerate, or got some other options as well.
I mean, Shiv Eviscerate's the cleanest.
Is it okay to waste your Eviscerate for this?
There's also coin SI7 Eviscerate.
You use your coin, though.
Yeah, it uses the coin, which is so good with those gadgets hands. Yeah. And developing an SI7 agent's not that great against Dragon Warrior, particularly going to Dragon Warrior turn 5, Blackwing Corruptor. Yeah. But even excluding that, there's so many cards like Fiery War.
He just hovered over the cards. He is thinking about Fan of Knives and the next turn go Shift SI.
Okay.
You know, he doesn't want to waste the Eviscerate. He doesn't want to waste the coin.
Yeah, Fan's also not amazing in this matchup.
And he feels like it's okay to, you know, take 3 additional damage. Be a little bit greedy.
Have a better option here. You talk about Rainier being salty. I already can see the veins coming out the temples of
Ekop. Like, it's my best matchup.
Yeah, best matchup. And
that was like my Ekop impression.
Ekop handles bad draws pretty poorly in terms of emotional responses to it. I always feel really bad for him.
I played Ekop for many, many games recently, and I won them all, actually. Every time. Every time he messaged me after I wrecked him, like, oh, that was so lucky. How did you do that?
How did you do that?
He could have asked you a lot of questions, like, what made you bring that deck? Or did you think I misplayed? Or, how did you do that? What a passive-aggressive way to say you didn't deserve the win.
All right, do we just shiv face and play the SI7 agent here? It's, like, not a spectacular turn, but it reserves a lot of potential for the future turns,
right? Yeah. You still keep Eviscerate with Teacher. You still have Gadget and Coin if you pick up Conceal. It keeps your options the most flexible. It kind of also makes your opponent do a certain play. Like, if he didn't have Blackwing Corruptor before, he probably can play him to 3-3, force you so you can use the Eviscerate with Violet Teacher. Kind of like put your opponent in an awkward position every single time.
You know what I think?
What do you think?
I mean, they had this one guy at Blizzard working that is just, their only job for him is to mess up Reynard's RNG. I think they fired him.
Oh.
He went to the Overwatch dev team instead?
Yeah, because he just got the prep as well.
Yeah,
that's okay. He's working on McCree balance right now.
His job is now to mess up Ekop's RNG. he got a different job.
All right, this Ravaging Ghoul is a little bit better than the last one, killing a 3-1 and no downside.
There you go.
But how does he win?
No, probably not.
This is something that even when me and Gara were practicing, we're just like, Dragon Warrior doesn't draw as consistently as you'd like it to, despite being a deck that's so dependent on curving out.
Right. I mean, that's the thing about Dragon Warrior. It has all these cards that are conditional on having a dragon in hand. So when you draw the right cards in the right order, it's just insane. Yeah. And when you don't, it can feel bad.
It is
one of those curve decks, but it has a lot of situational cards. Like Execute, right. Blood to Ikar, like Ravaging Ghoul, they're all situational cards.
Yeah.
Even Warrex, you don't want to just hit face.
Yeah, slam. But
Teacher Eviscerate's pretty strong here. Yeah. Clear the board, develop 4 power. Sets up for next turn, gadget, coin prep, nonsense.
It's crazy because his opponent already used 2 Ravaging Ghouls. So, where's the tokens going to get threatened by? So not only can you put by the teacher pretty confidently, your opponent has a hard time dealing with it. But at the same time, your opponent hasn't been utilizing his mana. So it's like you have to anticipate him having a ton of reactive cards.
Yep, but they're just not going to be the right ones with the Ravaging Ghouls out of the way.
Yep.
This is a rough game for Ekop. Right to the face. Good play.
This is the happiest Reynard I've ever seen.
I mean, he's designed a good Heroes of the Storm team.
Is this like the first time he has good draws in a tournament? He's like, damn, what is this?
No, absolutely not.
He's like, what?
He's trying not to smile is...
Yeah.
He's so right.
He's trying not.
Backstab, prep wow. man, wow.
Yeah, this is the rogue we all know and love at this point.
Yeah.
And E-Cop is just in... He might even concede. Like, it's just one of the points where, like, takes a deep breath, just tries to evaluate the situation, but it's so tough to fight back from this spot.
You can see E-Cop's, like, taking notes with his pen right now.
Yeah, just like any other card that I notice that might be the difference maker. Like, is he running one, two Cold Bloods? Is he running one, two Conceals?
Oh my god, this is fucking nightmare.
This. We're not even clearing that 2-1. We're busy killing him.
Yep, you got 10.
There's
damage.
No more ghouls. Like, how does he kill the 5-1?
Yeah. Surprise revenge.
I can see Reyna's winner's interview. Yep, a rogue is a good class.
Yeah.
Like, everyone who didn't bring it is an idiot.
Not
that was like a 10 out of 10 Reyna's quote.
He says that all the time. When you bring it, it's just wrong.
Yeah, you're just an idiot.
Yeah. All right, Ragnaros
Rogue's
and Belief.
Deck in the format.
Oh my god.
All right, it sets up lethal.
There you go.
In some universe.
For which play? For which play?
Yeah.
You didn't say for which play.
Well, he's only got 9... Or 20 damage, I see this turn.
19.
So, not enough.
That's not enough.
But Sap's a good start for it.
That's a good start. I mean, he only loses to Grom, right?
Yeah, and I mean, at this point, it's kind of like an embarrassment
no,
of riches. He's got so many cards and so many ways to kill
people actually run one Inner Rage, but...
Yeah, the Grom Inner Rage.
There's no way he can draw it like, in one card.
Well, I mean...
There's
possible.
Also people play Crew Task.
Really?
Yeah.
No, what?
Yeah,
really?
There is.
Yeah, a couple people do. I've seen it before.
That's not going to happen next turn, though.
Yeah.
It's an interesting choice when you have Blood Baker. It's such a similar card for one less mana.
What is Reynard salty about? Reynard seems kind of salty sometimes when he's winning.
He's worried about dying to Grom.
I see.
It's like one of those things where I know Andre enough to the point where like he always expects the worst outcome,
yeah.
Just so he's never truly disappointed.
It's like,
but when it happens,
yeah.
You can just see the depression wash over
still, yeah.
Slowly from the forehead down.
But you're right to be worried about Grom in this spot. That's exactly what you should be thinking about, right? Is there some way I can play around that too? Because it's the only way I lose. Can I cut my outs down from, you know, 2% to 0?
Yeah. And in this case...
No.
No.
Nope. Happening, bro.
Yeah. One thing to note, by the way, is that the list with JJ and Zivka played at DreamHack with Shiv and Argent Squire cut a Farseer, so there's actually no way for him to play around it. Assuming this is card for card the deck list, but it's looking exactly like it. All right.
Yeah, I mean, once you see the Argent Squire, you kind of just assume.
Yeah, that's true. Siphon the Gadget's in. Wait, actually, he's dead no matter
round
what.
Round two.
No, we did it. Yeah.
Yeah, but from Ecop's perspective,
yeah.
That was the best play.
Yeah.
Hit the auctioneer with the rag. I mean, that was the right play there.
All right, so that's it, right?
Yeah.
I mean, am I counting wrong?
11
Five.
Plus 3 is how much for them? It's 21 Four, for
yeah,
sure,
it's
right?
Lethal.
21 for sure. You can't even meme right, Gara.
We're just quadruple checking. Nothing wrong with that.
Yeah, yeah.
Humans are human. Sometimes they make mistakes.
Maybe he's thinking about the best way to BM Mika.
Oh, yeah. He's just like,
Yeah. No, he's not like that. Actually, I don't think I've ever seen Reyna BM in
game.
Yeah,
because he probably hates getting BM,
yeah.
Right? So he wouldn't
yeah.
want to do that to others.
Right. Through plays, I mean. Like, he doesn't, like, it's elaborately like, sap, like, a 1-1 or something like
he's
that.
Like, he's, like, passive-aggressive in some way.
I mean, there is also competitive reasoning for it. You show your opponent more cards than you need to, and you have to play the deck again. But it's 2-0 for Reynad, and right now he's about to send Ecop to an early loser's bracket.
Reynad's looking focused. He looks ready to go for the third game.
I mean, he doesn't want to be the first Epistorm player to not go through groups.
What does Reynad have left, actually, if he loses this? He has Druid and Shaman against Zoo. So there's sweep potential for Ecop if he wins this.
Yeah, Zoo always has really good sweep potential.
Yeah.
It's just good
you
luck hard countering that. Yeah.
Zalaze just kept sweeping with Zoo.
Zoo won every single match that I played today.
Wow.
All three of them. It was 9 Zoo wins. The only game Zoo lost were mirrors.
Wait, you won 9 games today?
Because
I lost the first 3 to RDU's Zoo.
Oh,
because he banned
okay,
my
okay.
Zoo.
Right.
And then I won the next 6 with Zoo.
But even then, a Zoo won.
I lost the game with Shaman in there, too. But
it is interesting. Your best matchup with the normal lineup is like the Zoo Mirror to kill the opponent's Zoo.
I mean, it depends how you build your decks exactly.
Yeah, your version is pretty bad in Zoo Mirror.
Yeah.
So you run no CDs?
Well, it has some advantages.
Yeah, you can discard Argent Commander.
Well, I have
every
the
time.
One that was the 30th card every time, but I don't want to talk about that on stream.
Sure, no problem, man. I got you. Eloise was actually telling me, because I brought Rogue to the tournament too, and she was like, yeah, like, Rogue for Zoo is actually like super even if people say that the stats favor Rogue.
Yeah, this is said by the best Zoo player in China, Qin Chang.
Why is it okay for her to say that?
Fair.
What? You just don't understand Chinese. Why are you so mad?
You're right. I should have stuck to Chinese school on my Saturdays.
Yeah. That's actually pretty fun.
Oh, my God. Well, why though? Can you clarify why it's so it's more even than people think? What's his reasoning?
Because Rogue can draw bad easily.
Yeah, like if you don't get prep, you're already unfavored. I feel like you don't get coin.
Really?
That's bad. You don't get prep.
I feel like keeping prep is not right anymore though. What? Unless you have a specific hand.
Like, if you haven't got coin, you are unfavored.
Number one card you keep. Definitely. It's the best card.
Keep it every time, even if it's by itself.
Every time.
Against Zoo, yeah.
Every time. 100%.
Okay.
Yeah, there's not a lot of spots involved in prep.
There's a lot of times. I mean, Zoo versus Rogue is one of the matchups I practice the most. Uh-huh. And it's like, a lot of times when I kept prep, it just like,
but it cannot
didn't do
be bad, man.
Well, I haven't practiced at all, but I'm really confident you're wrong.
Me too.
In the sense that, like, when I had it, like, I drew minions and I wasn't prepping anything, or I drew spells, I just didn't have minions. So I was just like,
but sometimes unlucky. You just gotta believe, man. Prep's a good card. That's how you win. The matchup's all about tempo, right? It's all about being ahead on board. Because if you can control the Zoo's board so he doesn't have stuff on board to attack with, then he can't use those buff cards effectively, and the value of his deck just goes way down.
I thought so too, man. I was keeping prep all the time.
Just keep believing. Okay. Just keep believing.
All right. Okay.
So what do we know?
Or is that what you want to say? So I didn't start losing games as Rogue. I don't know. The mind games, dude.
But, I mean, you can mulligan prep against me. That's fine.
Frodon is changing the meta.
I'm inclined to believe you, dude.
You probably should.
All right. Well, ECOP, it's kind of like you said. Zoo just rarely draws badly. It just has so many one drops now, and there's even more being squeezed in these days.
And no buff card.
No buff cards.
Imagine Reyna Teta prep.
That would be a good card.
Imagine a prep.
You could use it with your Azure Drake and Phantom Knives next turn.
Sick.
Just kill a lot of things.
I heard prep is a good card.
Yeah.
I think you always want prep.
I mean, this turn prep wouldn't have done much, but the
next turn
would
good to have in hand.
Yeah, be good to have in hand.
I want to tab here. There is no pressure card in his hand.
I don't think you have to prep.
Maybe he doesn't care about discarding a card here and then he taps.
Also, if you run Doomguard,
the hand's bad.
No, also you don't want to ever tap into Doomguard, right? Especially with Soulfire in hand. I think the Soulfire into...
That's always how it happens, man.
Trade the 2-1, Forbidden Ritual.
Oh.
So it
A lot of people don't run Doomguard when they play Soulfire.
But a lot of people also run one Soulfire in their Doomguard lists. That's like a European thing, I guess. I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, I have seen all kinds of lists. I mean, at this point, I expect anything from Zoo. Like, one Sea Giant, two Sea Giant, Doom Guards, Leroy, double Soulfire, zero Soulfires.
Gormox.
Yeah, Brand, Gormox. It's like, anything.
Prep.
Aggressive
prep.
Wild cards. That's it.
Oh, that's the prep.
Divine Shield Charge minions.
Oh, double prep. He can even zap now.
Yeah, that is.
Prepping.
Isn't
like
this ridiculous? Next turn, he can go Auctioneer, prep, zap, or something.
Yeah.
And we thought Reyna was behind.
Well, I mean,
Rogue just needs to decisively have one of these turns.
Yeah, those swing turns.
Yeah. And then Zoo just, like, they can try to come back. And that usually requires cards like Doomguard to come back immediately on board.
Yeah,
this is not too bad a position, though.
I mean, Zoo doesn't really, they don't really come back on board. Like, once they lose the board, it's kind of smork or die for the most part.
Yeah, the only exception is like Juggler and Forbidden Ritual and stuff. Like,
Forbidden Ritual is like the only one.
That's the comeback card,
What's the sequencing here? Direwolf. I guess you keep the Divine Shield. Rogue can't deal with that very easily.
Yeah, you want to trade off the one health minions when you can before anything else bad happens to him. better to save a taunt, right?
Especially with the Forbidden Ritual, you don't want to have too many minions.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, this is just very clean.
SM Orc.
Oh, wow.
No. SM Orc. Definitely SM Orc.
Yeah.
Whoa, and he also...
SM Orc for sure. You have more SM Orc next turn.
Okay.
There we go.
Oh. SM Orc. I don't like it.
Okay.
If there's no
Skulker or second Phantom Knives.
I mean, now he even like traded wrong.
Nice positioning, Kappa.
I mean, he traded wrong. He kept the taunt, so that way the positioning got messed up.
Didn't he trade off one Voidwalker?
Yeah, he could have traded both the taunts, and then it would have been... He would have kept the 1-1 on the left.
Yeah.
But I think he wants the taunt.
Yeah, exactly. It was unavoidable if he wanted the taunt. I was just kind of making a joke there. People always...
You try to explain.
The taunt's not, like, super important there. I think the positioning might be more important. Well, it's debatable anyways.
I mean, he's making these trades by sliding it down anyways, unless he wants to continue to keep the taunt.
Positioning is not that important versus rogue, I think.
You say that, and Betrayal is going to become in meta. Just watch.
Here it comes. I think we're losing the taunt right now.
I mean, hard to justify that, I think.
What, Betrayal?
That was actually a good justification for that placement. It's nice playing yoke. Around Betrayal. What a god.
Yeah.
That's true, man.
What a god.
I like this positioning a lot.
Yeah.
Really optimized that Direwolf Alpha.
It's like those people that play around Unstable Portal at BGH. All you can say is, what a god.
It's true. I mean, I've seen Yogg cast Betrayal several times.
So what now? Like, you go for the Auctioneer, of course,
Gadget,
right?
Prep Phantom Knives is...
Second Phantom Knives, that's pretty optimistic, but...
Yeah, I mean, well, there's...
I don't
the pessimistic
think
play
any
is
cast
to concede.
Can win if he cannot draw preps Phantom.
I mean, he's just going to hope for no damage.
Oh, I see.
This is not winning play.
I mean, it's the play that keeps him alive.
I mean, he's still
but
alive.
How can he win?
I don't know. But he can.
He has Leroy Goldblood.
I mean, he has. I mean, he maximizes his chance for going
for
to draw.
Another turn.
Yeah, also to draw Phantom of Knives next turn.
Right.
What is this? Argus? Is that lethal?
He
has 7 mana. 1, 3, 4.
That's
5.
One off. It's 5.
Yeah.
Plus
9 damage.
Yeah.
So tap into lethal. Easy. Peel.
I like Imkang Argus.
It's easy peel. Back up this lethal.
If you have that lethal, I think you can do it next turn.
Zoo never
I don't think
really,
this Imkang boss is going
yeah,
anywhere.
I like it. Yeah. I mean, he's not going to die, so Echo kind of does the same, right? He just has more draws, right? You play safe this turn.
Yeah.
If he doesn't deal with the board, you win anyways. You will have more chances to draw into lethal next turn as well. Put him to 1.
Ace.
No, you don't even have to put him to 1. You
just trade in a Thalmos.
Put him at 3.
Put him at 4 for Soulfire and Tombguard.
Trade off the Thalmos. Yeah.
Still win with anything like abusive.
Yeah, spell power is just way too threatening.
Yeah, Fan of Knives, second Fan of Knives. I like that as well. That's useless.
Well, I mean, can you do anything off of the like the double draw and prep?
What does save him here? Is there
yeah,
a way?
What all do we need to play off of this? We have
nothing, right?
You can
sap nothing.
Can you backstab the 3-2? He can draw sap and then he can prep sap.
Okay, let's go for the backstab.
Double backstab.
Yeah. Backstab into backstab.
Ooh.
I think he needed to draw second zap first. Prep, zap, and then backstab, but he's still dead then.
Ah, you're right. It's because of the charger in hand. Like, he doesn't know that. I think he's just trying to see if he can stay laws on board.
So well, that was nothing.
That's step one of a potential reverse sweep right there.
We got to keep the episode interesting, right?
Oh, what shaman does he play?
I don't
interesting.
Know. I don't think Raynad's playing the same
if
shaman.
If he listened to certain teammates and he would have brought the Bog Creeper shaman, he was trash talking so much.
Yeah. He was trash talking you?
Yeah, oh my god, it's the first deck. Like, he looked at it and he was like, that's a terrible list, I'm not gonna play that. Imagine
that's
he
how
had,
I knew.
Imagine he had that deck
actually,
right now.
Didn't we have this exact conversation, Gara, where like, Raynad trashed that deck and that's why I knew I wanted to play it or something like
oh,
that.
Yeah,
I made
yeah.
that joke.
Yeah.
And then you're like, yeah, and then it was just a joke, of course. We weren't like, you know, super
I didn't trash talk your deck.
Aww,
I only
you.
Said that your lineup is weird.
Weird. I agree. It's kinda
selfish.
Weird.
Selfish.
It kind of, it's weird, but it kind of works.
It's haha.
Listen, so if it ain't, sometimes it's not pretty, but you got to get the job done. Like, you don't really bring the most appealing lineup. Like, on paper, it doesn't make sense half the time.
Actually, you know what kind of druid this is?
What gave it away?
It's Sifka's Ketun Druid from Valencia.
How do you know it's Sifka's?
The Mark of the Wild.
I'm a genius.
Oh, was it the Mark of the Wild in the Mulligans?
Yep.
I didn't see it.
Okay. I like this turn one Voidwalker. It plays around the turn one Living Earths a little bit.
Yeah. Oh, that's a really good point.
The other option is Possessed Villager, which is just kind of worse because it trades instead of winning.
Yeah, there's no like two health minion early game that you're trying to trade into, right? Most of the time, if you're Druid.
Right.
In fact, I don't know anything that's... Oh, I guess Cthulhu's Chosen, but that's,
yeah,
that's not really it.
That's...
Oh, Twilight Elder. Okay. Cool. I haven't seen Twilight Elder in a while. Why is the card not ran that often in Cthulhu lists?
Twilight Elder?
Well, because it buffs for one instead of two, so it kind of doesn't always...
Isn't it like staple?
Help you?
Like, in, who's not
in
playing
Cthulhu Druid, it's pretty common.
But, yeah, it's like...
But
every...
the stats are... Yeah, just in general, like just as a
well,
concept of like
in general,
Warrior, for example.
Yeah, and Warrior doesn't get run because they're playing cards above their Cthulhu by two. And
yeah.
Twilight Elder, as any Hearthstone card, typically dies the turn it's played, so it only gets one buff off, which doesn't effectively buff your Cthulhu because you're trying to hit that break point of 10 for Twin Imps and Shield Bearer.
But for Druid, like they have Dark Arcana, like you can +3/+3, so it works very well with...
Right.
And in Druid,
Aracona.
It has...
Did you just Aracona. Drop that on us?
Okay, thank you.
And in Druid, it has insanely good synergy with Wild Growth and Innovate.
Yeah, exactly. That's yeah.
So it will survive two turns, sometimes even longer.
Yeah, and just the sooner that 3-4 comes down, the more punishing it is. Like, we see that with Totem Golem. A 3-mana 3-4, nobody's impressed by Spider Tank. But when your 3-4 comes down a turn early because of Overload and Totem Golem, all of a sudden it's value trading into everything.
Mm-hmm. It's kind of weird, right? 3-mana 3-4... like made sense for strong vanilla stats when we played 4-mana 4/5s as like the baseline power for like a really strong card. And then all of a sudden 3-mana 3/4s are just not really that impressive for a while. Mm-hmm. And now that a lot of cards rotate after standard, that power level never really adjusted. Why do you think that is?
That's like a very good example. Like Ogre Brute is a 4/4 with a drawback, but if it had no drawback, like the card is not played, right? And if it would be a vanilla creature with just 4/4 stats, it would be broken and would be played in every single day.
Yeah, I think Crit made that exact same argument. That like in Handlock, for example, Ogre Root was played and people still just thought that was
it's
a trash card.
It's just one stat different.
Yeah. It's interesting. Well, this is kind of an awkward hand for the Zoo Warlock.
Smooth enough. Peddler, one drop this turn,
yeah.
Right?
It's still something like pretty fragile.
But he has double PO in his hand, so he's not scared of whatever.
Would you like to walk in more? To have one more power? He trades with a 5 drop.
Well, the Druid's swipe turn is coming up, so one health minions are a little bit sketchy.
Yeah, but...
And we're playing a Possessed Villager, it's like...
Yeah, it's true. I mean, Elvis is kind of right, though. Like, no matter what Druid plays, he could just play Power of the Whelming, trade, and just like develop whatever he draws. Because I'm pretty sure he's drew like all of his low curves, so he's only going to hit higher curve from this point on.
Yeah, it's very good for the Zoo.
Yeah. It's also interesting because Renat chose to go Cthulhu Druid, and I thought Cthulhu Druid kind of struggles against Zoo.
I mean, he has Shaman left.
Yeah,
if it's
so
an
he must
Shaman.
Really think his Shaman's not that good.
Yeah.
Maybe he's feeling out his opponent.
I mean, if he's
might
playing
be a control shaman.
Might be a control shaman.
Or aggro shaman.
Imagine the irony.
I mean, normal control shaman, not...
Oh.
I actually
know. You are hating on the deck.
I actually know what kind of shaman he plays as well.
Oh, okay.
But
I don't actually know.
I think he didn't play a single game of it, so he just doesn't know how good it is.
Okay, good.
That sounds exactly like what happened.
He just doesn't know if it's good, man.
Sometimes you just gotta believe. It worked out great for him in game one.
Dude is gonna play and win and be like, oh, that's a pretty good deck.
Yeah.
He actually took it from templestomp.com from the meta snapshot.
That's a good website.
I'm not even kidding.
Then what about archon.com?
No, you want a templestomp. They have the best decks ever.
And at least, yeah, it's true. I actually haven't seen an update to teamarchon.com in a long time.
Yeah. That's gonna. Continue.
I mean, would you just kill the councilman? It's a super huge threat.
I mean, yeah. That so card is kind of the nightmare for Druid, right?
Before he really need to clear it before he played Dark Arakona.
Yeah. Yeah, I like it a lot.
Next turn.
Yeah, you have to go Rev Roots, and that because you want to just play your Dark Arakona back to back.
I don't know, killing that councilman is...
Yeah, it's too important. And then the Azuldrake is good whenever. Like when you have the swipe eventually, you can spell power swipe on 9.
Yeah, it just feels bad because it's so not mana efficient.
But what if I nourish for mana crystals and just put 3 damage on the council?
No, I don't like that.
Just take a heat. Take some hits.
I don't like it.
I mean,
we're getting closer
it,
to Yogg.
Yeah, well, it also is like... I mean, you know, gets him closer to, like, he can snipe an extra and play Dark Arakoa.
Yeah.
And then, you know, in the event that he gets, like, things like Spell Power Swipe, that's also his way to come back on the board, too.
Is there a Kasun Druid play Yogg? I actually seen some.
I've seen it before.
I have.
It wrecked me so hard.
I believe, actually, your practice group runs it, like, Neobility in them, like Silent Storm. I think they do run Yogg.
I don't think so.
And now he lost because he didn't kill the minion.
All right, this turn, Raven Idol, empty check, steal the 8-8.
I mean, that made the difference. He couldn't have played the Sea Giant if he would have removed the minion.
Oh, you're right.
And now it...
Oh, man.
I mean, you kind of have to expect almost everyone has Sea Giant in this tournament.
Yeah, that's something to
except Soleil.
I went a different direction.
I don't have Sea Giant.
Except Frodo and Soleil.
Good turn for a life tap. We don't need to put a lot of Forbidden Ritual things in play.
Wait, is this lethal? Why life tap?
7, he's 10. Does he have another power in hand?
You mean BM life tap?
Wow, tied up. And Raynad's going to have to reveal that Shaman. And E-Cop sent it to Game 5. Season finale. Will Joey finally be able to overcome Yugi?
It's Kaiba.
Oh, sorry. Kaiba. Oh, that is even more juicy because Joey never beats Kaiba.
Then yeah. Joey will suddenly be the hero of the show.
Well, I mean, it's still like a
hero for the day.
Yeah.
What will Renato always think at this moment?
Probably making excuses on like if he wasn't running a business.
Or maybe he should have cleared the councilman.
It's true, clearing the councilman was. The right play.
Oh, there you go. Dengu Shaman.
So it's a mid-range Shaman with Thunderbolt of Failure.
That's not the worst against you. But.
Yeah, I mean, I like there should curve. Be 2 Lightning Storms, which means you have chances.
Yeah.
You can always believe.
Oh. Yeah, and he has Totem
Pole. I'm pretty sure Ekov would expect, at this point, Bog Creeper Shaman. Right?
That'd be sick. Like, I don't think that changes much of his mulligan right now.
Yeah, he's getting rid of it.
Oh, man, this is actually pretty good.
Yeah, you're mid-range Shaman, you still have Coin Totem Golem.
That's the best
that's good curve.
That's the best card, like the best thing to have against Zoo.
And if E-Cop has to mulligan all 3 cards and he misses a 1-drop on the very low chance, then, I mean, that's like a Shaman blowout hand. You have Totem Golem, Argent Squire, and then Totem Totemix.
So. Pretty sure this is a very easy mulligan for E-Cop. You hard mulligan for 1-drops when you go first.
Yeah. If you don't have the coin, you need something to do on turn 1.
What is he thinking about? Keeping a Gengar's like no way in hell you would ever keep. Even against Bog Creeper.
Maybe just thinking about general game plan of like the likelihood.
Maybe he's thinking about food. Like what am I going to eat later?
Maybe he missed that Raynad mulligan and he's waiting for Raynad's mulligan.
Yeah, that's also a good thing too. Could be like those small little edges you get. Alright.
Argent Squire, yeah.
Decent.
Reasonable hand. I mean, you're never really truly happy about Beast Surgeon on 2.
Wow, that's a good pickup. He has all he wants.
It's Coin Totem Golem, right?
I believe so.
I agree.
A lot of people just tell me
he has
Coin Totem Golem.
He has that into Squire into another Totem Golem from the Tusker.
Oh, you're right.
That's a pretty sick curve.
Get the Overload out of the way. Yeah. So you can get the Totem Golem out first, trade, and then place it.
Oh, Malatide.
Oh my god, the one of. I was just thinking about this is the one way this goes badly.
Let me
so
check out Reynard's expression.
Abusive. Yeah, he's just like
that's literally
his eyes,
the only
like,
combination
yep.
of cards
yep.
he could.
No, there's power overwhelming too. I can just kill
I
it.
See.
Like if you play
yeah,
power
that's
overwhelming,
not the same.
It's not the same, of course. I'm just saying that was another out to kill the Totem Golem.
Right.
Oh, that's the power overwhelming.
Oh. Yeah, but look, he tapped on 3, so
disgusting.
All things considering, like especially if this Tusker Totemic rolls pretty well.
Is this the totemic turn?
That's actually true. You might
three, five.
Consider Storm.
No, yeah, it's definitely because he cannot play Giant. It's Giant is 5 mana. It's his 4 mana turn.
One problem with the Totemic is often the Totem just dies on board, right? If it's not something good. Right.
Yeah, I don't think Rena will count the mana of Sea Giant here.
Yeah.
It's just like...
He's counting the chances that double Abuse Token came off the top.
Yeah, that's what he's doing the math on.
He can definitely do it, too.
But this is Shaman versus Zoo. How do you play around Sea Giant?
But then again, if he goes Storm now, it plays around a lot of cards. It plays around Dark Iron Dwarf, it plays around
Defender Argus.
Yeah,
Defender of Argus is probably the big thing that I'm most...
If he's landing Storm now, he cannot do anything next turn. Yeah. That's very, very bad.
Yeah, it's bad, but...
He can next turn landing Storm so that he overload on turn 5, and next turn on turn 6, he can play Fire Elemental.
Yeah, that's actually really important. Now that you have 2 Fire Elementals, that's like... your swing on top of Lightning Storm.
I think you play Totem Golem here.
All memes aside, I mean, most things to come out here should be pretty decent.
Nice.
That's a great one.
We're high rolling.
I don't mind rolling Acolyte of Pain.
He's going to overload for 3 next turn.
Just for, like, the extra measurement, too, Vaynad's playing a golden Duskrat Totemic. Vaynad usually plays all golden cards, but...
Yeah. Role player dance game.
Yeah. Okay, so Defender of Argus.
I mean, the main thing is really to keep Sea Giant in mind. And I think this was the best turn to play Tuskar Totemic.
Yeah.
Also for the future, because the zoo will always have more minions.
You get 2 value trades. Very nice.
Yeah, it's pretty sick.
Is there a world where you play Feral Spears instead of Lightning Storm?
Dude. Oh man, Brennett will never go for the RNG play. He will never just go Lightning Storm and try to hit the 50-50. There's no way. This is not how he plays. He would never do that. Ever. Always suspect the worst case scenario.
But he can also just...
Look at his face. He's thinking about it.
Lightning Bolt and do nothing.
He's like, I'm never lucky. I can't go for this play.
You like pass. That's pretty interesting too. I guess Direwolf Alpha is like really bad, but... He also passed on like 3 mana.
If he played Direwolf Alpha, then we can just Lightning Storm after that.
It's so bad.
And then you overload for the Fire Elemental.
I think that's not important. We really need to get a very valuable Lightning Storm.
You like Feral Spirit, Lightning Bolt, and not attack. Mm. Okay.
He cannot play Storm next turn. He cannot play anything next turn. This is why he's debating so much the Lightning Storm, because he cannot overload for 3. He wants to overload for 2.
The right
play would be to Storm and right Hyrule, but this is not how Reynard rolls.
What about Feral Spirit and just trade 3-2 to the 3-2 and then pass, so you keep that overload? Like, staggered.
He's going for it?
Wow.
His luck. His
like
luck.
A go! 2-3-2.
That was easy.
Wow.
What is happening?
Ooh. I mean,
that's pretty good.
Kaiba always wins.
Kaiba, man.
Forbidden Ritual, that's the answer to Storm.
Yep.
Yeah.
That's
how many
disgusting.
Storms you got, buddy? Just
that's
the one?
That's disgusting.
He doesn't have the Double Alpha, but what he does have is a very cheap Sea Giant.
So what he really wants next turn is a Hex.
Ooh. This could be pretty bad if the juggles land. Pretty nasty.
You have to think about the math on... What happens if I juggle that 3-1?
Reynard is done. Get me out of here. He's going to hit the Tusker.
His favorite card.
Don't hit the Tusker.
At least he has another YouTube highlight.
Reynard's going to quit life if the
He'll Tusker. Be fine. He's a big boy.
I don't know. I'm looking at his eyes right now. Looks like he needs a drink.
Not with the first juggle, at least. Oh, let's make it interesting.
Sea Giant.
I would like to play look for a card from Dark Pedaloo first.
That's a full board.
Ooh.
It's a buff card or something.
1 mana, 8/8, kill your 3/1.
He's sad.
That right?
He's very sad.
Yeah.
You can see he's not happy.
If he draws Hex, though, it's actually not a bad situation.
And he's in a great spot if he draws Hex.
What? If he draws Hex, he's still
dead.
Wow. He's dead? Why is he dead?
He just Hexed Lightning.
There's like a lot of things over there. I don't know.
I mean, he has Filamental into Filamental.
Oh!
Are you kidding me? You go Bolt Hex.
Bolt Hex,
easy.
And then you have a Fire Elemental next turn.
Where are your lot of things, Saleh?
Nah,
I only see
fine.
Two
he's
things.
Got Reliquary Seeker.
I only see 2 things in a Pokemon.
Oh.
It's enough.
Wow. But I mean, you
that
can
so
out.
Sick.
How? Who's gonna be the one who gets the value?
That, man, if that power roaming.
That right. That might have been like the most lucky series in terms of draw for Reynard.
Right.
Ever, because that was pretty sick.
I mean, it keeps him competitive in this game at least.
Yeah.
But it doesn't mean you win the game.
Yeah, not
still
yet.
Hard to say.
I mean, it's still open, but I mean, that was pretty sick.
Yeah, because Fire Mantle trades pretty easily just for like a one attack.
I mean, he need a hex there. Like,
yeah,
absolutely.
You don't have to stay competitive.
Fire Mantle is just a great card at this point.
Yep.
So sick. It's pretty much as good as it gets. And then next turn you have ability to use Rockbiter to also start fighting back on the board.
And the opponent has to use... Oh, he can play the 5-5. That's crazy.
Well, and
if he draws
something.
He draws.
I mean,
he does.
Of course he draws something.
Well, it could cost 4 plus or be a spell.
He can play all of it. It's really good.
Yeah.
That's as good as it gets from the zoo.
That's...
I mean, dumping your hand is always what you want.
Yeah.
Man, Reynard won on the Lightning Storm, and he's getting the Hex off the top, but it's still like, Zoo just doesn't quit, man.
Man, he needs to draw a second Storm. Even though it is a full board, it is not like that much damage. If he can deal with the 5-5.
So, without Lightning Storm, Thing from Below is a full tempo swing.
Oh, yeah, yeah, that's pretty sick. How much mana is it at this point?
He's really totemed that often, though.
No.
Alright, so...
I think only once. Only the... Oh, actually, Totem Golem and Tuska Totemic, so it's two totems.
Man, Zoo's a good deck.
Look
at
so
game.
Powerful.
Yeah, there's not much he can do. This 5-5 is pretty disgusting. Is he gonna
would you part ways with Rock Biters and just kill the 1-3?
I mean,
gotta get through
yeah.
it eventually.
Yeah.
Totems to make it.
Your argument against it is that we're just trying to win with something like Storm or Thing from
yeah,
Below.
Yeah, right. He's like, at this point, I have to draw my second Storm. I think he also has Alakir. So
I gotta say, man, all things considering, a lot of things went in right for Reynard too. He got like Mana Tide off of Tuskar.
Yeah.
He had a good early curve with Coin Totem Golem.
Yep.
He got Lightning Storm Hyrule.
Yep.
Yeah,
and he got that Hex off the top.
Yep. And still just.
And Ooh. Still just got blown out. This game is not even close. I mean, the health total, sure, but like that's a lot of Flame Imp life tap damage.
Zoo is a good deck.
Zoo is a fantastic deck, and it kind of breaks my heart because
I
feel like...
Who invented the deck like this that is so good?
Who would release this deck onto the world?
Why isn't Reynard bring Zoo? When Zoo is a great deck in
Wait,
a format,
Reynard's not playing Zoo?
It's iconic to
Yeah,
me.
That's actually one of the few decks he's
It's like Zedalot not bringing Breeze to a tournament.
That is so next level. Echo beating Reynard with Zoo, where Reynard doesn't bring Zoo. I mean,
that is delicious irony. The writer went all out for the irony in this season. I like it.
Good season, Hearthstone.
That is quite the plot twist in the season finale. Would you agree?
Yep.
Another power blowing.
This is scripted.
Power play.
I mean, it's not over yet, but...
Oh, that's a good draw. But, like, one of the better draws. I mean,
is
what
it,
else
Is the 2-5
draw?
Scarier than the 5-5? No, not with this board. It's full.
Yeah. He only can get one more damage.
Imagine he gets, like, another great card from the Tuska. I mean...
like Totem Golem.
You cannot complain about RNG in this game.
Yeah.
Yeah, you can. Just say, God, that Zoo drew so well.
Yeah.
This was the game with double abusive on turn two, right? That was
that's
kind of what
I
it
mean,
was.
I mean, even the totem goal, like the taunt totem, is pretty good. If you would have decided to play the flame.
Yeah, I was kind of feeling the flame taunt.
He doesn't want him to trade his stuff off and play more stuff, right?
Oh,
he cannot
you're
trade
right,
the froggies.
You're right, you're right.
He doesn't want those tutus to die.
Dude, I was actually kind of thinking if all of these taunts somehow managed to die, and all of a sudden Reynard just whipped out. By the way. We make sure security is a very big issue here.
But can Reynard even win from this point on? Let's assume you top deck Lightning Storm.
Or I was just thinking, like, what if, like, the taunt just went away and then Alakir just came off and just, like, won with 12 to the face? That was just, like, the most random way to win ever.
But he's so low on life.
Wow, this is one damage off.
No way to trade and play a minion, gain attack? Actually... Maybe. If he trades a minion, plays Peddler, gets a Soulfire or something. Oh wait, never mind. Spectator Boat's bugged.
So I was actually thinking when he like power overwhelming trading to those Fire Elemental before, he could sacrifice his own frog if he worry about there's no space.
Yeah, I don't like him keeping the froggies. But seriously.
Ooh. Nope, that's
never
it.
Never lucky.
And that's going to wrap up. Ekab completes the reverse sweep.
Yeah, crazy.
And a plot twist for the ages on 11:11 p.m. Make a wish, everybody.
I actually want to
dream
interview
can come
true.
Right
I wish y'all gets nerfed.
Ekab's in everything. Densuke.
I wish Tempestone would be respected.
Team Anubis plus 200 points. Ooh, not bad. And they could use it.
Wait, is that our team?
That's the NA team. It's NA versus EU.
Oh, we are NA though.
Yeah. Very sportsmanlike handshake and job well done to Ekab.
They both didn't BM this game at all.
Yeah, they were very professional. I mean, all things considering, we were making it much more juicy than what it turned out to be. All right, Ekab. So looks like you started off rocky, but you finished strong. What was going through your head through some of those games as you were playing it? What was going through your head during some of those games that you played? Like, what were you kind of thinking?
I mean, not losing was in my mind all the time. I just wanted to play the best as I could, and I think I did that. And yeah, now here I am, the winner.
Yeah, woo! Congrats, dude. You guys have any questions? Okay, so you guys can ask a question. If not, I'll just ask a question.
Go ahead.
All right. When you looked at like Reynad's lineup, what were you thinking? Like, what was the like mentality going in? Because he brought like Rogue, but he didn't bring like a Warlock with it too. So it's a little bit unconventional. Like usually when people bring Rogue, they bring Venolock and a few other things too. So.
I mean, yeah, the Rogue pick surprised me. I mean, just basically because it's not one of the top four decks, right? But. Yeah, I mean, Rogue is definitely a very good deck. I don't blame him for picking it, and it definitely had the potential to 3-0 my lineup. But of course, Rogue can struggle sometimes, so I was like, yeah, I don't need to ban that, and yeah, I'll just ban War because it's the strongest class.
Sure. On the couch, we may or may not have decided that you're kind of like Joey Wheeler from Yu-Gi-Oh, and Reynad's like Kaiba. Do you feel like this is an appropriate analogy to how you guys were facing off here?
Joey Wheeler?
Yeah.
Oh my goodness. Well.
Tall and handsome.
I think maybe that's accurate. That might be a little bit accurate, I guess.
Okay, good. At least he's self-aware. I like it. Cool. All right, do you guys have anything you want to say to Ekab? Maybe not questions, but just.
That was great.
Zoo versus Rogue. Who's favorite? Zoo versus Rogue. Who's favorite?
Did it what?
Zoo versus Rogue. Who's favorite?
Well, I guess it depends.
50-50.
Rogue should be favored in theory, but it all comes down to how much pressure can the Zoo have, and also if the Rogue has the coin or not.
Right.
So that's pretty much it.
Okay.
Good job, Raki, Reynad.
He's not sending you a Christmas card, FYI. But congratulations, you're going to play Tice in the winter finals. How do you feel going up against Tice?
Against Tice? Yeah, I don't know. Sometimes I win against him, sometimes I lose against him in tournaments. This will be no different. It can go either way, I think.
When's the last time you faced off?
Last time I think we faced off in like a match for third place in the tournament, and that one he won. But yeah, we'll see how it goes this time. I can beat him, I think.
You're due.
I mean, I can beat anyone here.
He's long overdue, man.
I can beat anyone here. So can you. So
the pregnancy of victory is very ripe within Ekot's belly. I'm awaiting it, man. Just unleash it on the world.
Yeah. Well, I'm looking forward to the match. So.
All right. Cool. All right. So that does it for our interview. Our second match is done. So that means when we come back, we're going to have Tice up against Ekab, and then following we'll have Terrence versus Reynad. Should be juicy to see what ends up happening between both these matches. So stay tuned, guys. More action from Seat Story coming up right after this.